Hi there, everybody, and welcome to Sim Soul Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight, we are talking to a young man who went through quite a bit in the pursuit of his passion. He's actually still on a difficult journey to achieving his goals, but he's determined to go the detoured route as long as he gets to his destination. We've got actor Desmond Dennis as my guest tonight. First, though, we're checking in with one of our previous season's guests. Coach Craig Butler joins us to catch us up on what's been happening. Hello, Sir Craig. How are you?
Hi, Simone. How are you?
I am very well. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, man. I'm doing well. I'm hanging in there. Physically not the best, but we're getting the job done. Getting the job done.
What does that mean, day by day. Sir? What does that mean?
No, just some medical complications, but I'll be okay.
Okay. All right. I won't prod you. We've seen each other a few times since the show aired. Tell me a little bit about your experience having been here. I got a message from a friend of mine post-show to say, you know, it was odd for her to see you in that light and to see you actually get emotional in that way. Was that amongst the general feedback or what kind of feedback did you get?
Yeah, everyone was messaging me and saying, Craig, we never knew these things. We never knew you were like this. We never knew how emotional you can get about things. But, you know, the truth of it is most people see the bulldog and because that's what's needed. They don't realize that there's really someone with a big heart behind all of this. But hey, it's life, you know. You have to do the best that you can and live it.
Yeah. And so this vulnerability that people now know you possess and that you're capable of, has it helped you or has it hurt that bulldog image?
Oh, man. Those people who are close to me always know me. They know I'm a softie. I'm a pushover. Trust me, all you need to do is push one of those buttons and the tears flow. But the reality of it is, it has helped in terms of the general public getting an understanding of why I do what I do.
Right.
And
right.
Basically who I am as a person. So it's really helped a lot. And, I really want to congratulate you and empower you and send you love and, you know, give you more strength to continue, especially in light of some of the things you have gone through recently.
Oh,
and,
gosh.
You know, just let you know my heart is with you, you know?
Oh, gosh.
Heart is with you. You're not easy. You're not easy. But go on, stand up, Sam.
Oh, gosh, Coach. Thank you for that. I really appreciate that. How are your boys doing? What's going on with them?
Well, great. We got a club in Visay, so we have 10 new players over there now and playing in Belgium. We have a new coach that we built through the system. He's retired and then as a footballer, so we sent him as a second coach there. We have a lot going on. The Manning Cup is going on. Whisper is fully signed to Chelsea now, so that's great. And he's in the national team, and Leon is doing awesome, coming into his own as a leader in the national team and showing the qualities that are needed. And you know, I've seen a lot of positive things going on for football, but more so the vehicle of football for youngsters and things getting better. We still have the haters and the disloyal people that go around chatting crap, but you know what?
You're
if you never have them around, you couldn't enjoy the good people that much. You know, you would really get to appreciate good if bad wasn't there sometimes.
How's Kyle?
Yeah, Kyle, all right, man. Kyle's still Kyle. You know, Kyle's still Kyle. He's on his path. Him doing the music. He's doing all the things he wants to do. And he has a baby on the way now.
What? So, you're going to be a grandpa?
No, we understand. Yeah, I'm a grandpa 10 times over.
Additional, 11.
I have a 15-year-old or a 16-year-old grandson. And I have a lot of others coming through. And Travis has one. And Leon has one and a half, now another one on the way. And, you know, we're having a lot of things. So the life, for me, is good. But what I'm looking forward to is the day Kyle is going to understand what it means to be a dad and how hard the decisions that he'll have to make in the best interest of his kid. And that way, I think, he will mature more, you know?
That's powerful, Coach. That's powerful.
Yeah, man.
So let me ask you, my final question is, how are you taking care of yourself?
You know what I'm doing? I'm enjoying Casey, Haley, Shelley, all the people that I love in my life, spending a lot of time with the family, and my blood pressure is going down whenever I'm with them. You know, yes, the pain is still there with some of the issues that you have, but so what? You know, it's part of life. I'm enjoying my life. You know, I'm enjoying what I do. I'm trying to enjoy it. I'm trying to, when I see, you know, the girls getting their, doing their exams and getting all distinctions and those things, it just makes me proud, you know? I'm so happy and to see everybody shining and everybody making their way, Xander, the boys over in Belgium, they're finding their way and the path, and to know I was a vehicle. That is, that, let me tell you something, there's nothing better for your health than that.
Yeah.
Believe me.
Yeah, I believe you. I believe you. Believe me, I believe you. We did book up at a graduation, Andrew's graduation. Who was graduating for you again, Craig?
Not a boss, man, you know, so the whole of Phoenix there. Casey, the boss, was graduated. The entire academy.
The whole of Phoenix. You're so right. You guys took up all the seats in the. Yeah, oh.
But.
Excellent. So good to catch up with you. I pray that all goes well with you in terms of your health so that you can continue to enjoy your life and enjoy those you love and to continue to make a contribution to these young boys because they really need it in their journeys to become better young men. Thank you, Craig Butler. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
All right, folks. When we come back, bye. We are talking to actor Desmond Dennis after this. Soon come. So this is really a story about passion and purpose and persuasion and obstacles to getting there, but pursuing nonetheless. Desmond Dennis knew he wanted a career in the performing arts, specifically in drama, acting, right, for the longest while. And even when others were telling him he was wasting his life and his years in pursuit of that passion, he decided he was going to follow his own path and not that others were trying to lay out for him. He is still walking that sometimes difficult, lonely road to self-actualization. He pauses when he must, but he has not stopped. And he's here with us tonight. So good to have you on our set. I want to call him Mr. Pitchy Patchy. I want to call him Mr. Ring Games. I don't know which one, but it's good to talk to Desmond tonight. How are you?
Thank you for having me. I'm well, thank you. How are you?
I'm very well.
Sending you so much love, so much light.
Thank you. Received. Can never get enough of that. We're going to talk about the journey you're on, sir. Ultimate goal is to make it to the ultimate place, and we'll talk about where that is. But let's talk about how you got here. Humble beginnings in Clarendon.
Yes.
Burnham Field, to be precise. You ain't race no care, though.
No.
Okay, just checking.
In fact, I've never been to...
You're too untrue.
Yeah. Because when I tell people that I'm introverted, they really don't believe me, but I have a genuine fear of crowds and large gatherings. And that was a space which was a high energy, high lots volumes of people type of thing. Plus also, mommy used to think it was really dangerous for children to be there. So she, at the time that it was popular, she'd never allow me to go. But like my older brother, Kino would have gotten a chance to enjoy what that would have been. And you know, you'd have seen the excitement along the road
but
anyway.
You're not good there.
But me,
you're not good
and I was never for it. I was a homebody, if you get what I mean.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. You told me growing up. You mentioned mommy. Mommy used to sell outside the school gate.
Yes, my mom she was very popular for it actually. And I think it was not just because she was, you know, selling there, but the value that she brought to the kids' lives. I had so many brothers and sisters who were not my brothers and sisters.
Oh, bless her.
Just because of, you know, how she would have treated the young men, the young women who would, you know, support her business. But yeah, she did that for years and years and years and years and years, and that's actually what sent me through basic school, primary school, high school, college, all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You say you grew up in proper bush days.
Proper bush, no cable, two station. We'll only mention one here.
Yes. Good on you, sir. And then you came to Kingston. You remember coming to Kingston?
Yeah.
One time in grade 2. You took a day from school.
Yeah.
coming to Kingston? You never really knew why you were coming to Kingston.
I did not.
Until you got to Kingston.
Until I got to Kingston. And in fact, I don't think I fully appreciated what was going on until after. And I think that that's something that's stayed with me in terms of me being able to reflect and spend time with self after events. So the whole thing happened. And it was on the way back. I was just like, wait.
What just happened?
What's that? You know? And that kind of, I guess even at that young age, kind of jolted me into recognizing that a new reality was about to be for me. I didn't know what any of it meant naturally, but I knew that something in my space had shifted.
And what was that reality? You came to Kingston to go to court.
Yeah. My parents were in the middle of separation. And so, you know, took the day off from school. I thought it was going to be fun and games and all of that. And to be fair, it was a nice little outing, you know, seeing the buildings and the this and the that. But, you know, you're in the session. It was a very intimate thing, I remember. It was almost like what these corporate boardrooms are like now. So just like, I remember a long board table, wooden table.
Wow.
And the judge, a man, he was sitting at that end there. And I was just there. I think I walked with some paper, because I always had paper and books and things. And my parents were seated across each other. I was just down there to myself. And ever so often, you know, he'd throw me a random question. And naturally, because I was a smart child. So I'd be answering him, and he'd be very impressed with, you know, the way I was carrying myself. And then after the fact now, he kept, I noticed in retrospect. So years later, I'm reflecting on what.
I'm just sitting here, I'm seeing it.
Yeah.
Because it's still so vivid in your mind.
Yeah, and it's because I would have spent that time after the fact to reflect on what that conversation actually was. I remember him saying, who do you want to stay with? And I didn't know why he was asking me that, because at that time it didn't dawn on me what was going on.
Wow.
And then I think I said, Mommy, I'm not sure. I don't remember that bit of it. I just remember the question being posed. But I know that after the fact, the decision was that I would stay with my mom. And then my father was awarded visiting privileges. So every 2 weeks or every other weekend, I'd spend with my father and my younger siblings. And that was my life until high school, mm-hmm. pretty much. So it would just be me spending weekends with daddy, but spending life and growing and learning and, you know, loving mommy.
You know what's funny about what you said? And I'm so glad the Office of the Children's Advocate is a sponsor in this program. It's not a shameless plug, but a lot of our guests mention having gone through situations where their parents separated or divorced and the impact it had on them. I don't think a lot of parents understand.
Yeah.
The fact that you can sit here as a grown man and talk about this event and take us there with you. You never knew anything before. Nobody said anything to you before. No discussion was had with you prior.
Right.
You didn't even know there was an issue. Was there even a post-discussion?
I don't recall.
I genuinely don't recall.
And you see, the truth is, in Jamaica, there are different tiers to conversations like these.
Facts.
If you're from, you know, certain types of conversation, hey, so this is what's happening, da 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 da. But I feel that when you're from a certain background, life is just lifing. And so it happens, it happened.
It done.
And you go. You know, so you are back in school the next day, mommy's back to work, daddy's back to work, life is back to life. And that's the sort of reality that you have to get used to, being poor.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's deep. And so true. Levels.
Yeah, there are levels.
Levels.
At all levels of life and existence, I feel. Yeah.
Wow. See, I learn something new on the show every night. All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we talk more with Desmond about how he maneuvered through that, found his passion, and the difficulties he started facing from there. We'll be right back with Desmond after this. Sometimes you just have to take bad thing, make laugh. He said, I'm asking where you go, Desmond. Yeah, your friend, I'm asking.
He said, where you there? You never come to school because, you know, my mommy, my parents would insist that all their kids stayed in school and they were, you know, attendance up, neat, you do your work, all of that. So that was a given. So me not being there at school, it was a thing. What happened to you yesterday? You know, you go Kingston, man, go up on trip. Eat, you know, eat patty and drink orange juice and you feel good and yeah, you know, yeah, celebrate with them. Yeah, and
you left out the part where your parents split up.
Yeah.
I got you. So you went to live with mommy, but even before that, you were mentioning that the judge thought you were very smart. You're an avid reader, avid churchgoer, because yes. Even when mommy wasn't there, she insisted that you go.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, you started, I'm going to say preaching early, but you don't like the word preach.
I really don't.
Yeah.
I don't like it for me.
Right.
And what I was required, or what I felt at that time I was being, you know, asked to do. But yeah, when I was younger, I was an avid reader, and mommy always reminded me that the first book that I ever spent considerable time reading was the Bible. So she'd remind me that after school, basic school, I'd come home and just read Psalms.
Wow.
I wouldn't even understand, you know, what they were saying, but it was just, I loved words. Even from then, I loved words. And just the matter of figuring what they meant. And, you know, naturally, your basic school words are bigger than you. But just knowing that you're figuring it out, breaking it up like they taught you, and just doing that. And then church, because my family is a church family. Even to this day, my father is very active in the church. And mommy, when she was there, was a very, very solid woman in the church. In the sense that my mommy was an acts of service woman.
Yes.
And so she would donate goods, service to building, ensure that events, food is there. And in fact, some of the major successes my church enjoyed at the time was a result of ideas that she brought to them. Hey, let's do a Christmas thing and let's just sell some things. Let's do a concert. Let's do a... And so all of those little things I would have watched her do.
Which is so funny because you eventually got to a place where you questioned religion. Did you question religion? Church.
Church.
Let me do the lead up. So you knew, and in retrospect, because you do a lot of things looking back, that you had this gift. This thing that came so naturally to you, which was drama, out of your pores.
Yeah.
The church was dissuading you from this.
I mean, it was later. And it was never directed to me. It was the stuff in passing that, and just the attitudes too. Mm. So I feel that, for instance, when you're in church as a child, you're encouraged to the Christmas recitals and you're encouraged to do the skits on, you know, Youth Sunday, Children's Sunday and all of that. But then I feel that at a certain point, and it's not everybody and it's not every situation, but I heard, you know, just certain scant regards towards what I felt that I was supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
And it made it very difficult for me to process how I should keep doing it if it is that the people that, you know, I grew up seeing and learning from would have been looking down on it because it wasn't like a traditional job. Because the issue, I don't think, is doing it. The issue is doing it as the main.
Gotcha.
Because, again, when you're from a certain background, you ought to gear yourselves towards doing something upstanding,
lawyer,
upright,
doctor,
lawyer,
chief,
doctor, teacher, nurse,
gotcha,
all of that stuff.
Gotcha.
And to be honest, like, I was on that path for a while as well, because again, being smart, you're seeing options for smart kids. At a very young age, I read Gifted Hands, Ben Carson. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I was just like, wait, his background is similar to mine. I wonder. And so I convinced myself that because I saw myself in his childhood self, that maybe being a doctor was what was meant for me, just because there were so many parallels in that book to my own life at the time.
Yeah.
And so it made it difficult for them to process that when I made the decision to do it, I think it made some people uncomfortable because, what, you'd have spent all of this money for this?
But how did that affect your relationship with church or religion?
Yeah, I feel that, and it's just my personal thing, I feel that grace ought to play a big part in discipleship. And I feel that...
Felt. Come again. Re-rack, re-rack. Say it again.
Yeah, I feel genuinely that grace ought to play a significant portion of discipleship. So, for me, it is not up to you, the individual, to decide where another individual goes, because that's not your journey, and that's not the path that God has laid out for. You know what I mean? Like, your journey is unique to you.
Yes,
and in just the same way, nobody ought to judge you or stifle you because of what you're doing. I feel that outside of disrespecting God, disrespecting, you know, the space, disrespecting spirituality, if someone is clearly doing something that is well-meaning, like it's not a crime, it's not anything like that, it ought not to be frowned upon because perhaps that's where God wants them to go and perhaps that's where their true ministry is. You see what I mean? And so it made it difficult for me to process that this might be something that I might not do because it's making all of these people who I love uncomfortable. And so that created a huge gap for me. And it was just like, for me, I feel that rather than making people uncomfortable, I ought to just remove myself from the situation and allow them to be and be their best selves, because I genuinely just love when people are, you know, good.
You know what's funny about what you're saying? Grace plays an important part in discipleship. I think that's such a... did you really write that one? Because that's powerful, you know, sir.
Never write it.
I'm going to borrow it. But the grace that you wish had been extended to you in that moment would have been so good, because all of that, Des, fed you down a road where you took up something you didn't want to take up, and it almost destroyed you.
Yeah.
So you went to UA with the sciences.
Yeah.
As this big A student who was doing so well all along in your course, and you went to UA and you saw yourself slipping.
Yeah.
Grades slipping.
Yeah, not knowing why, because I was doing all of the things I would do. For me, growing up, you go to class, you pay attention. If you don't understand, you ask your questions. You practice when you go home. And I was doing all of those things still. But I just found that, it's like with athletes, when they train, they spend months and months and months and months and months and train. But when they get to the line, they just need to hear one thing before the gun goes off and it throws off their whole rhythm. Their drive phase is off, therefore their follow through is off, and therefore their top end, they won't get to activate. And I felt that a lot of what I experienced at UA was that, just doing all of the work, focusing, doing all of that. And then when it got to the exam, you're just like, wait, I did this, but where am I supposed to go with this? Because even my lab grades were solid, tutorial grades were solid, but
your exams,
I could not for the life of me get through exams well, and I could not understand why. And so that pressure of acknowledging that, hey, you were this guy, you were this guy, you were this guy, what is going on with you now? It really just dragged me down.
And you ended up in a state of depression. We're going to talk about that and how he was able to crawl out of that by just listening to his heart and following his own purpose after this. We'll be right back. We are back with Desmond, talking about pursuing his purpose and his passion. It was when you got to UA and you realized you were not doing well in the sciences that you made a conscious decision that you were going to step fully into the thing that you were doing that took no effort out of you. And I said to you, you know, sometimes we don't realize that our gift, because it comes so easily to us, is a job. We can't eat because we can enjoy what we do. But it's a foreign concept to so many.
Yeah. And I feel like that's the great demarcation for them, because a job ought to be a desk and a tie and a shirt and a this and a that, and you sit and you 9 and you 5 and you... But really, if your passion feeds you, what really is the issue, you know? And if your passion isn't causing you to bring destruction on your society, what really is the issue? People find fulfillment in different things. And so I feel that in just the same way that, you know, you're encouraged to discover your fulfillment in a traditional job, people who decide or who recognize their gifts in other non-traditional spaces ought to be encouraged in the same way, because those things can be repurposed for the betterment of the country.
Absolutely. Your gift is not my gift, it's not your gift, it's not mine. We don't
exactly.
all have the same gifts, and
exactly.
we can do different things.
Exactly.
How did you get out of that depressive state?
Well, first of all, I didn't even realize I was going through depression until my mentor, Michael Holgate, mentioned it to me. And it was one of those tough conversations that really just made me very, very aware. And I think that was perhaps one of the first times I was ever forced to recognize how much self-awareness helps
yes,
with it.
Yes.
You have to be able to track
yes.
where you are on a moment-to-moment basis so you can recognize immediately like what your triggers are and stuff like that. So I had been going months, like after recognizing that the grades were just going, I'd started to withdraw, and so people would only see me during class or doing whatever or during drama club practice, and then they'd not see me, they'd not hear from me, they'd not... because I would not use my phone, I would not reach out to people, because the truth is when I'm there in the darkness, I don't want to see, do, feel, hear anything, anyone.
Felt.
And so
felt.
It was after not seeing or hearing from me for a while, he reached out, hey, I need to see you. And then he just started asking me some questions, and I guess my response is, you know, would have been, you know, pointing him out. And then afterwards, he was just like, do you realize that you're depressed? And in the moment, I almost laughed at him because I was just like, me, depressed? No, I'm fine. Mm-hmm. But I feel like that sort of is just, I think that's very common for us as a people. We don't like to be associated with, you know,
stigma,
anything.
Man. Stigma.
Yeah. So, no, I'm good.
Nice.
What do you mean? Da, 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 da. And then he broke it down. This is what's happening. This is what's happening. This is the result of it. And then in that moment, it brought me back to, I guess, my first time with depression. So I'd been living with depression for years and years, never
and
recognizing
you still are.
That.
You still are.
Facts.
Yeah.
But in third form, I said, like, doing very, very well, topping my stream, topping my class. And leading up to the final exam, summer term, I think it was called, they stole all my books. They stole all my books because, again, I was very, you know, so all of my notes, everything, da-da-da-da, very detailed, whatever. All my notebooks were stolen weeks before the exam. And I feel that because I had trusted, because I trust people a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
And I feel that because I was very open and generous just in sharing, like if I know something you ask me, I would tell you, I would volunteer information. So I felt that recognizing that betrayal and it shattered me. And I feel like that moment, I have bouts of that moment,
yes.
that moment of,
yes,
is all of this worth it? Like,
yeah.
Do you need to do anything besides just being, and how long are you going to be for? What
whoa.
Does it make sense you push?
Whoa,
does it,
whoa,
you,
whoa,
it I mean?
Whoa.
And
besides
so,
being.
Yeah. Does it make, because that's literally the questions I ask myself. Because for me, I learned to work very hard from observing my parents work hard. You know what I mean? They were poor, but they never made being poor an excuse. And they worked with people who helped them take care of us. And so I learned that. So I worked hard. So knowing that I worked that hard just for somebody to come and steal my stuff, I was just like, what is the point of all of this?
You had people, eventually decided to just do what made you happy.
Yeah.
And your star started to rise because you had people in the industry who just recognized your talent
it.
And started putting you in shows, and your mom eventually came and saw you perform.
Yeah.
And realized that you are a bona fide big deal, Des. You are a star.
Yeah.
And that would have been the only time.
Yeah, I think, again, because of the whispers and the talks and this, I think my mom started to worry for me, especially after recognizing that, you know, it's not going along the path that we had discussed or whatever. But I feel that when Auntie Delia did, it was Old Fire Stick at the time, and we did tours around the country, and the tour to Clarendon, she got to attend that. And that was the first time my mother would have ever seen me outside a church perform, and even during rehearsal, she was worried, how are you going to be doing a play with Valer and Tidalia and Dion Silvera? As a youngster, she was very, very worried about all of it. But then on the night, people kept whispering about, you know, my performance. And afterwards, she went to Auntie Dahlia and Auntie Dion, and she said, take care of him for
take
me.
Take care of him.
And that's pretty much, they are two of tens of people that, you know, keep pushing me and encouraging me because they recognize that this is really something that I'm supposed to be doing.
Hold that thought, sir. Two of tens of thousands. We don't have tens of thousands, but we have some. Go ahead, Laurie.
Well, go on, Desmond. Hey, listen. I don't know how they got my number, but I'm very happy they reached out because you deserve everything where you get, brother. You deserve everything that you're getting right now. We've been friends for well over 10 years. You know what I mean? We started out on the stage, we shared the stage together, and now we're working together in our creative capacity. And you are extremely talented, brother. No, nobody tell you nothing different. Although I know you know, you know. You know what I mean? Because, you know what I mean, you're an actor, you write, you direct, you know what I mean? You teach. You are a treat. You are a treat, Desmond. You are a treat. But that's why you plant your roots and then start grow some more, brother, because the sky is the limit. And we're there for it, bro. We're there for
it. It has been such an honor watching you over the years and how our friendship has just blossomed. You don't know when we spirit find each other and the love come up, but I'm just so thankful for you in my life. Desmond, you're funny. You can't act. Everybody know that. But your brilliance is something that I never wanted to not count. Any stage, any set, any place in the air of the world, may I find one pain that may I come to you. Thank you so much for being in my life. Desmond, this is just the beginning. Every door we open, a year is for got you. I love you. Everything that this life you deserve. And we'll just be together, and I'm forever grateful for you. Love you, my brother.
Good people deserve good things. And you are one of the best people me ever meet. If I never feel you, me don't know what me would have done, honestly. You're kind, you're smart, you're driven. Anything women need, me know you got my back. As a performer, you are one of the most dedicated people me ever see in a life. You inspire me to be the best I can be every time I touch the stage. And I just want to big you up because, boy, me don't know what this industry would be if I never for you. Me don't know what the future of the Jamaican theater industry would have been. You're just so talented, bro. You're so talented. I just want to big you up. Enough love.
I am happy to know you, happy to call you a friend, my brother, my producer, my director. You know. Thank you for all the trust you've put in me, all the belief you have in me, the ways that you have push me all of the time that we sit down and we reason.
You have so much talent in your little finger that some people don't have in their entire body. And I love that this gift that God has given you, that he has entrusted you with, you've never ever wasted it. I have seen you work so hard for the wins, but I've also seen you taking the losses with such grace. And I just want to thank you for keeping me close, for sharing your dreams with me, for sharing your talent with Jamaica and the rest of the world. Cause hello, we the pan Netflix Star Truth. The original tribe is so proud of you, and we just want to say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. We love you. I love you. Continue to be great.
Hi Desmond, I am so incredibly proud of you as a friend, as family, and as a fan, because in case you never know, I am without a doubt one of your biggest fans. I have been so lucky to have had so many adventures with you over the years, so many creative adventures, so many life adventures. There have been tears, there has been laughter, and I'm so grateful for all of it. I would like you to know, Desmond, that there is a space in my heart that will always be yours, And I'd like you to remember that no matter how far our feet may take us from each other, and I know your feet soon carry you to some amazing place very soon, just remember we're walking this path together. I love you. Bye.
I know that your journey has not been an easy one. You've been through a lot and you just keep going. And I want to encourage you to just keep doing that. Keep putting that one foot in front of the other and keep going. You work so hard. You put so much of yourself into everything that you do. Every project that we've done together, like, Desmond, I got overdo it. And I want you to just keep being positive. Keep sharing your love, sharing your talent with everybody, right? Because what's coming, wow, it's gonna be amazing.
Desmond, anyone with eyes in their head can see how brilliantly talented you are. And if anybody has seen you on stage, they would realize that you are a force of nature. What a lot of people might not realize is how wickedly talented you are as a writer and as a director. And I'm just very proud of you, especially because you're such a decent human being. I'm looking forward to the greatness, even more great things that you will accomplish in life. And I just feel very proud to say that you're like a son to me. I'm also reflecting now on how we met, and you came up to me at the Philip Sherlock Center and you said, "Are you Michael Holgate?" And I said, "Yes." And you said, "You're going to be my mentor." Now, who does that? Desmond Dennis, bless up yourself.
Desmond, I smile when I remember how we met. You are not in my faculty. You're not a member of the Caribbean School of Media and Communication, but you found your way into my radio broadcasting class. Shall I tell you something? I recognized there and then that you were a strategist. You had a plan. And that plan was to equip yourself in whatever way you could and to the best of your ability to take on the arts. And then I saw your talent as a performer. You're really, really talented.
Desmond! Oh, congratulations, son. I remember the night mommy, your mother, brought it to Daly and I. And she said to us, "Take care of my son in a Kingston." Oh, I'm so proud to be a part of the journey. Those two plays Daly wrote, and man, you nailed the lover boy in Old Fire Stick, later named Ring Games. And there we did same difference and same kind of vibration. The roles were so clearly defined. Man, with you, the theater fraternity is looking bright. So keep pressing, keep motivating, keep inspiring. Boy, you know, baby, just be good and all the best. And remember, Auntie D loves you, and don't forget to pray. One love, blessings, and love always, Desmond. Mwah!
You know, the way you live your life is just a constant reminder to us that no dream is too big and no dream is invalid. The secret is to just get up every day, go after what you want, despite the adversities that may exist. We are proud of you. We are proud of all that you have accomplished today, despite the many curved ball life has thrown at you. And the way you live your life is just the best lesson any big brother can teach. Love you loads.
I'm happy for you, man, for this tribe you have made in life so far. I know you would make it, because I remember when you were 7 months old, playing with a ball. I've never seen you walk before. The ball roll away from you, and you just get up and run for it. And on that day, I know that you would not sit around, but whatever you want in life, you would just go for it. So keep on going and keep on striving for higher heights, and one day you will reach the top with the help of God.
I feel how under it is.
Thank you for that.
You're welcome. Mommy's not here, but I know she's proud. You know she's proud.
I feel like that's why it hurts so much, because her recognizing and saying to Auntie Dela, you know, take care of me, I feel like that was her giving me her blessing to do it, because she finally understood what I meant when I was, you know, talking to her about stuff. And I feel like that's the part I struggle with most, just knowing that she's not here to see me becoming, you know. I'm very grateful for the people who are in my life, who have come around and who are now my biggest cheerleaders. And I know that if she were here, she would be among them naturally.
Yeah.
But it's just rough being able to, you know, grow in a space and grow in passion and not be able to say to her, see dear, this is why I was doing it. Mm-hmm. Like, this is it. This is what I'm working mm-hmm. towards. But I needed to hear those. I needed to hear those love notes.
Okay. Soon come back. Take the break, guys.
Oh.
Tell you guys that Desmond has been accepted to the London Academy of Music and Dramatic Arts 3 years in a row. He hasn't been able to accept because of tuition. By the way, it's 6 people every year that accept from around the world. 6. 3 years in a row he's made it. He hasn't been able to take up the space because it's $3 million and he doesn't have the money to do it. But he has made it a mission to end up there. And so you've been working your tail off, sir. And you've made some of the payment already because you decided the space is gonna be there when you're ready. Are you hopeful that this will happen?
I mean, so this is again where I have that weird little, you know, you have a friend who just disappears and come visit you ever so often. I feel like that's my relationship with depression, because being able to see something that's like right there. Like, I literally sat with the principal of the school who said to me, we need you in this space. And for whatever reason, just like, you know, the money now come together right way. You just have to keep saying, okay, hopefully I get it next year. Hopefully I get it next year. Hopefully I get it next year. And that's been. And so every time it gets to a certain point in the year, you just remind you, Jesus, like, is it going to happen? That kind of. But
you actually said, these are the moments. This is the only time in your life where you.
Yeah, this is the only time that I've ever regretted
being
poor or being born poor, because finally here is something that, you know I do great at. And it's one of those things that if I had access, I could just go and do it, you know? And it's just one of those reminders that, you know, where you're from really can dictate how you go about living. And so I'm working really hard to change that, like, that scenario, so that in the future, if something else like this happens, I'm better able, I'm better equipped to take it on fully and not have to wait.
You actually reached out on social for folks. Anybody who wants to help Des, please, please, please help him to realize this God-given actualize his God-given passion and realize his dream, because I just know it's going to happen for you.
Thank you.
It must happen for you. And you say what you're learning in the meantime is to trust his timing.
Yes.
I saw you in Pitchy Patchy. You were brilliant. You are masterful. Saw in Ring Games. You were, I mean, you wouldn't have been able to do those things had you been in London, right? And that has built your profile even more. So you're learning to trust the timing.
And just to be patient.
Fantastic.
Because I feel that, again, God allows you to accomplish certain things at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm deciding to not, you know, harbor on what's not working, but I'm trying to find ways to ensure that me being here, how can I make the best of each moment being here, if you get what I mean? And I think that that's like a change in my perception. If you're above ground,
hey.
God not done with you yet.
Yes,
you know what I mean? So what can I do today to make myself better, to make the people around me better, because that's also a passion of mine, just strengthening the people around me and just ensuring that everybody is in a better space mm-hmm. and a better place mm-hmm. with whatever dreams or goals they have. So mm-hmm. that's really what I'm working towards and trusting him.
That's why you're missing a good tile. When you pour into people, he pours into you. Mm. Just hold strain, my friend.
Thank you.
Just hold strain. I'll be there to see it. I'm going to be there to see it. Thank you, Des. How Thank lovely you. To sit with you.
Likewise.
Don't we meet some lovely people in this space and see their hearts, which are even lovelier. It's time for affirmation, everybody. So man plan and God wipe. Easy to utter, hard pill to swallow. So many times we wish we could pull the levers for things to unfold exactly as we'd want them to. And we find it so hard to understand when they don't. It is hard to be trusting, faithful, and patient when we feel we've been waiting so long. But we must also know that everything unfolds as it should. And sometimes our plan for ourselves is not part of God's master plan, or that it is, but sometimes the answer isn't no, it's just not yet. So in the meantime, we continue to push, my people. You put in the work, you put in the prayer, because when it finally happens, whenever and however it should, you will see it was the right time and it was well worth the wait. So tonight we are affirming, however difficult, I will trust his timing, his path, and his plan. That is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you for watching, everybody. We're back next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, ever blessing, and please remember to count your blessings. Good night.